Okay, so let me quickly share the screen. Okay, so let's have a recap of what we discussed in the previous class. I hope the screen is visible to you. If there is an interruption, please let me know. So in the previous lecture, we are currently in the module 4, and in the previous lecture we discussed about the Bayesian belief networks, right? And we are on urge to finish the module 4 after today's lecture, that is discussing the topic EM algorithm, right? We are going to take up the lecture, today's lecture on EM algorithm, and also since it is part of our lab experiment, EM algorithm, which is experiment number 8. So we'll also look upon that. We will discuss a few set of examples with respect to this, what is this EM algorithm, and we will take the experiment as well, right? So in today's lecture, we'll be finishing up module number 4. And regarding the IIT syllabus, whatever we cover before, one day before IIT, will be there completely for your IIT, right? So with no further ado, let's start. And before that, let me show you the experiment number 8, which is on the grounds of again EM algorithm, right? So EM stands for basically expectation maximization algorithm. So in the experiment number 8, what we are going to do is we are going to apply the EM algorithm, right? EM algorithm on a set of data that we have that we can take in the form of CSV file, right? So no specific data set that they have mentioned, like they have mentioned in the experiment number 7, that we need to consider the medical data. But here in the experiment number 8, you are free to choose any data set, right? But it should be in the form of a CSV file, right? Comma separated value files. So in the experiment number 8 here, along with the EM algorithm, we are going to apply one more algorithm, that is K-means algorithm, which you guys must be already aware with. But still, we will have a look upon what is this K-means algorithm as well as what is this EM algorithm. And the objective of this experiment is to apply these two algorithms and then compare the results of what is the accuracy and precision that we get on the same data set when we apply these two algorithms, right? So the experiment says to apply the EM algorithm to a cluster set of a data set stored in a CSV file and use the same data set for clustering using the K-means algorithm, right? So these are the two different clustering algorithms, but we are going to apply both of the algorithms on the same data set in order to basically compare which one is suitable more according to the data set, right? So once we apply both these two algorithms, we are going to compare the results of these two algorithms, and then we will see that what is the ultimate accuracy or the precision and the ultimate quality of the clustering that we get, right? So here in this experiment, we can add the Java or Python machine learning libraries or classes or APIs inbuilt, right? Inbuilt APIs that we can make use of. So with this, let us start off and understand what is this EM algorithm and what is K-means algorithm as well, right? So like I mentioned just now, this is our experiment, that is to apply EM algorithm to cluster a set of data stored in a CSV file and then use the same data set for clustering the K-means algorithm, and then compare the results of these two algorithms and comment on the quality of clustering, right? So we will have different examples as to what is the accuracy using the EM algorithm and what is the accuracy and the output that we get using K-means algorithm, and then we will see. Right, so first things first, we'll discuss the what do we mean by this EM algorithm, right? So as I said, EM stands for expectation maximization, right? So as the name suggests, we try to maximize the expectation of a particular instance of the data set, right? Or particular feature that we are trying to extract from the data set, right? So this EM algorithm is basically divided into two parts, right? First is we see the expectation, right? Expectation of a data set, right? What features that we expect, what are the variables that we need to focus upon more, and then we try to maximize those expectations, right? So this algorithm is basically divided into two tasks, you can see. First, we decide the expected variables, and then we try to maximize those expected variables, and then we apply those techniques on the data set to get the expected accuracy for that particular clustering. But the question is, when do we consider this algorithm, right? When do we understand that this particular algorithm can be useful here, right? So some of the use cases that we can say that when we can use the EM algorithm, that is expectation maximization algorithm, is when we have a data which is only partially observable, right? As the name suggests, partially observable. We don't have the liberty to observe all the data available, right? We can only observe the data partially, some part of the data, some portion of the data is when we observe. In that case, we can apply this algorithm, EM algorithm, right? So the clustering that we do here in the EM algorithm is basically the unsupervised clustering, right? I hope you must be already aware with the concept of supervised and unsupervised, which we have covered initially during the introduction of the subject, right? So supervised and unsupervised, though the clustering here in the EM algorithm is unsupervised, but the learning what is happening actually in the model, it is a supervised learning, right? So basically, just to give you a refreshing idea of supervised and unsupervised. Supervised learning is when we have the data set which is labeled, right? When we have the labeled data set, when we tell the system to we give the input and we also give the output, and then ask the system to learn, that is something called as supervised learning, because we have a labeled data already available. So when we don't have a labeled data, right, then it is the unsupervised learning, right? We are going to only give the input to the model and ask the model to learn depending on some observations, and then come up with some labels, right, some categorization which we can label later. So that is basically unsupervised. So back to the topic, when to use this expectation maximization algorithm, right? When we have the data which is only partially observable, right? Number one, when we have the clustering which is to be of unsupervised clustering, right? Wherein only the target value are unobservable. But the learning that we want to have is supervised learning, then also we can make use of the EM algorithm. By supervised learning, as I said, there are some there will be data set which will be labeled a data set, right? And we can say that we can use this EM algorithm for the supervised learning with some instances attributes unobservable, right? Some instance attributes which is unobservable, right? So when we use this EM algorithm, for what we are going to use this EM algorithm? Basically, when we want to train the network, right? When we want to train our Bayesian belief network, right? Which we have already seen in our previous classes, previous lectures, right? The Bayesian belief network. So when we want to train our Bayesian belief network, then in that case, we can make use of the EM algorithm, right? And then, as I said, for unsupervised clustering, and also for learning hidden Markov models. Hope you remember the Markov models when we discussed about the statistical models, different statistical models, right? Stochastic gradient descent and those models. So this particular algorithm can also be useful when we want to make the hidden Markov models learn, right? So basically, just to give you a background of Markov models, Markov models are the models which says that the next step or the next state depends on the current state and not the previous other states, right? So that's what just a brief idea about the Markov models, right? They tell the next state of the model, right, depending on the current state and not on the history or the previous states that the model has. So anyways, but when we try to learn, when we are trying to make the hidden Markov models learn, In that case also, a EM algorithm can be useful. Right, so being discussed about the use cases of the EM algorithm, let us have an understanding of how do we evaluate this thing? How can we generate data from mixture of these K Gaussians? Now, K is nothing but the set you can say instances, so clusters, right? So generating data from the mixture of K Gaussian, right? So I hope you all remember the Gaussian curve, right? And as you can see here on the x-axis, we have the number of instances, right, which is denoted by x. And on the y-axis, we have the probability of those instances x, right? So as you can see that the graph, which clearly says that when the number of instances is less, the probability increases slightly. But as and when the number of instances goes increasing, right, as the number of instances keeps on increasing, the probability also gets stronger, right? So that's about the Gaussian curve and how can we generate data from the mixture of, let's say, K Gaussians. So let us deep dive more into it and understand to better depth how can we get this thing, right? How can we have each instance X generated, right? So choosing one of the K's Gaussian with uniform probability is the first step in generating the instances X, right? So once we choose one of the K's K Gaussians with the uniform probability, then we can go on to generate an instance which is again at a random, right? This is again a random according to that particular Gaussian, right? So when we apply this EM algorithm, the EM algorithm first, as I mentioned, it is particularly divided into two parts. First is expectation, right? We look forward for the expected variables, and then when we then we maximize that expectations, right? So what is given here? What do we have with us when we try to estimate those k means? So the given that we have is the instances, right? The instances from the x generated by mixture of those k Gaussian distributions, right? We will have again a understanding of what is this Gaussian distributions on them, right? So this is what is given to us, and what is unknown is the unknown means of those K Gaussians, right? Or the mean values of those K Gaussians. So right from mu 1, so on till mu K, right? And we also don't know that which instance, let's say instance XI, was generated by which Gaussian, right? We right now we are not aware of which particular instance is generated by which Gaussian. So this is what we know right now. This is what is the information that is given right now to us. But the further we have to determine the maximum likelihood estimates of those means, right? What is the maximum likelihood estimate of all the available means of K Gaussians, right? So in order to do that, we have the for each instance, what we are going to compute, we are going to compute the value for yi, which is again, as you can see, it is the it depends on three values, that is xi, zi1 and zi2. Now what is this zi1 and zi2? In general, this xi is the observable value and zij is the unobservable value, right? Remember what I have told in the beginning of the EM algorithm, that the EM algorithm, it is suitable for the data set when we have partially observable data, right? So in that partially observable, let's say we have xi, which is observable, and zij, which is unobservable, right? And zij will be 1 if the particular instance xi is generated by the jth Gaussian, right? So zij in this case, Zij will be 1 if the Xi generated is by the jth Gaussian. So similarly, Zi1 will be 1 if the xi generated by the first Gaussian, right, and so on. So this is how we have the full description of the each instance, right? But let us go ahead and pick the initial hypothesis for these mean values, right? Like I mentioned, it will be divided into two. The algorithm will be divided into two steps. First is the E step, which is the expected value, and next is the M step, which is the maximization value, right? Maximization likelihood hypothesis. So how do we have these expected value, right? So we already have a formula for that. That is to calculate the expected value E of Zij, right? Where Zij is the unobservable values. So the expected value among this Zij of each hidden variable Zij, that assuming the current hypothesis, let's say assuming the whatever the current hypothesis H is equal to the mean of first and second, right? That means H is equal to mu 1 comma mu 2, right? As long as it holds, we are going to calculate the expected value for each hidden variable, right? That is xij. So once we compute, that is using this formula, we have the expected value, right? Expected value among the some complete set. So once we have the expected value, now the second step, the second part of the algorithm is to maximize the likelihood hypothesis, right? To select the maximum likelihood hypothesis. So which we have already seen in the previous module as well, right? How do we compute the maximum likelihood hypothesis, right? So for that, let us have a new maximum likelihood hypothesis, right? And name it H dash, right? So H dash will be equal to mu dash 1 and mu dash 2, right? The mean value of mu dash 1 and the mean value mu dash 2. So once we have this value for each hidden variable Zij and the expected value E of Zij, as we have computed here, then we can replace this H value, which is the previous value, with the current H value, which is the H dash, right? And in order to do that, we are going to put it into the mean formula, which we have already seen, right? A mean formula, mu of j, which implies the summation of all the expected variables, right, and the instances xi, divided by the mean, the summation of the expected variables E of Zij, right? So this will give us the mean value for that particular variable, and then this will help us to compute the maximum likelihood hypothesis. Now we have we know the expected variable and the maximum likelihood hypothesis as well. So that is the two important tasks the EM algorithm does, right? So this is very important. What is this EM algorithm and what are the different tasks that we compute here? Right. So since our experiment says that to apply EM algorithm as well as the k-means algorithm. Now you know about the EM algorithm, so let us move ahead and discuss what is the k-means algorithm, and then we will be applying both these algorithms to see what will be the outcome, right? So with the background understanding of EM algorithm, we will proceed further to understand the k-means algorithm, and then we will apply both. Taking an example, we will understand what is the difference between these two algorithms, how are they better from each one, which one is better from each one when it comes to classification, clustering, right? So the k-means algorithm, it's a very simple algorithm again. First we take these sample space, that is sample space is initially partitioned into k clusters. Sample space is nothing but the initial data set that we have, the versions with the sample space, right? So that complete data set will be partitioned into some clusters, right? Let's name it as k number of clusters, right? K denotes the number of clusters that we have, right? K can be anything. It can be 1, it can be 2, maybe it can be 0 also sometimes, but usually it will be from 1, 2, and so on. It depends on the what clustering that you are trying to do, how many types of clusters that you want to form. Right, so k here is the number of clusters that we have. So let's say we have a data set and we have a sample space for that data set, and we are going to divide or partition that data set into k number of clusters, right? And initially we are going to make some observations which are on randomly random basis, right? Some observations which are randomly assigned to the clusters, because those clustering, though it is initial partitioning, but there will be some common observations which we can clearly see through these clusters, and depending upon that we can make some random observations, right? We can make some observations depending upon this random assignment of the clusters that we have seen, right? So once we have these small clusters, right, any, let's say, k number of clusters, here in each sample, right, for each particular sample, we are going to calculate the distance, right, distance of that sample from the cluster. The cluster is nothing but the distance of that particular sample from that sample place to the centroid of the cluster, right, the center of the cluster, because cluster will be spread, right? So we need to have a centroid of the cluster, and we are going to compute the distance of that sample from that centroid, right? So we will also look upon how do we compute these things, but time being, just remember that we are going to compute the distance from the observation to the centroid of the cluster. Right. So once we have the distance of these samples from the centroid, when we see that if the sample is closest to the cluster, then we don't do anything, right? We leave that sample to that cluster itself, because it is closest to that cluster. But when we have the other way around, it, when we see that a particular sample is very far away from a centroid of the cluster, and there is another cluster which is much more closer to that sample, then there is high probability that that particular sample belongs to that closer cluster, right? So this can only be done once we have the distance of that sample from that sample to the centroid of that cluster, right? So once we compute the distance, the next job is to check whether how close it is, right? If it is close enough to a particular cluster, then we don't do anything. We leave it to that cluster itself. If it is very far from that cluster, we see, is it close to any other particular cluster? Right? Is there any cluster which is near to that sample? Right. And this step, this particular step, that is partitioning into cluster, calculating distance, and then checking whether it is closest to the cluster or not. These steps are repeated. These steps are continuously repeated in a number of iterations to make the clustering more easier, right? To make better clustering as and when we proceed, as and when we have more data for the clustering, we get the better classification, right? Which sample space belongs to which cluster, right? So number of repetitions, of course, depends on how much computation power that you have, how much accuracy that you are expecting, and other factors, right? So the more the number of iterations, that it is going to give you better accuracy. So we are going to repeat these strip for, let's say, for some iterations, let's say for 6 iterations or maybe 10 iterations. It depends totally upon you, right? So basically, we are going to partition the sample space into k number of clusters, then calculate the distance of each sample from the centroid of the cluster, and check whether it is closest to that cluster or is there any other cluster closest to the sample. Right? And depending upon that, we can label it or we can assign it to that particular cluster. Right? So this step is repeated continuously. Now the question that arises is how to calculate this distance. Right? We can clearly make it out like which one is closest to which cluster, but for that you need to have the distance. Right? You need to have the value, the length there. So to calculate the distance of a particular sample, observed sample, to the centroid of the cluster, we have different distance functions. Right? Hope you remember the Euclidean distance formula. the Manhattan distance formula and the Minkowski's distance formula. Right, so we have different distance functions that we can make use of, which will be making use to compute the distance of these sample from its centroid of the cluster. Right. So let me show you a basic algorithm now. Since we know what are the different steps in the k-means algorithm, let us have a basic understanding of the algorithm, the k-means algorithm. Right. So how this is the pseudo code for the basic algorithm for the k-means. Right. So first thing is to select k points as the initial centroids. So these will be our k partitions. Right. K partitions and the initial centroids. Why the term initial centroid? Because these are just randomly selected initially, depending upon some observations, right? Depending upon the observations made upon a random assignment. Right. So these are the initial centroids, and as and when we repeat the process, we may change our centroids. Right. We may change the value of the centroid of our clusters. Right. So once we have these k points as the initial centroid, we are going to repeat two steps. First is form k clusters by assigning all the points to the closest centroid, and then once we assign it to the closest centroid, we will again recompute the centroid for each cluster. Right. We are going to recompute the centroid for each of the clusters. Now till what point that we have to recompute is another question, right? So we are going to continuously recompute the centroid of the cluster till the point we see no change in the centroid values, right? So we are going to repeat until we see that the centroids are not changing, right? The value of the centroids doesn't change. So when we encounter an iteration wherein we see that the values of the centroids are not changing, then we can say that it is mostly clustered, right? The complete sample space is properly clustered, right? That's why we don't have any change in the centroid. Right, so that's the basic k-means algorithm. Now let us discuss these things, right? So these are the other details of the k-means algorithm which you are already aware of, and these are the Euclidean distance, like I just said, right? So just an example, let's say when we have three points, okay? So that means we have three clusters, and the centroid of these three clusters are 2,4, right, 5,2 and 8,9. So there is one cluster at the coordinates 2,4, there is one cluster at the coordinate 5,2, right, and there is one cluster coordinate at the coordinate 8,9, right? So we need to compute the center. These are already the centroid of these three points, right? These are the two-dimensional points. Now how do we compute the centroid point, right? Centroid point of all these three clusters by using the formula here, wherein we take all the x values, right, and all the y values by averaging it with all the three values, right? Since we are computing the centroid for three points, it will be divided by three. So 2 plus 5 plus 8 divided by 3, 4 plus 2 plus 9 divided by 3. So this will give us another centroid point, which will be the centroid of our whole, you can say, all the three clusters. Right. So our new CP, that is centroid point, will be 5,5. So this is our new centroid. Right. So likewise, we can compute, and just for an example, as you can see, when we apply k-means algorithm, just let me give you an example here. That let's say we have this in the first iteration, we have the plot which looks something like this, right? We have some green values right now here, we have some values indicated in blue, and here in the top we have one more cluster which is basically the collection of all the three colors, right? All the three values, you can say. These colors denotes the different labels, okay? These are the different legends, you can say. So this one cluster contains, you know, almost all the three values here, right? So the more number of iterations that we do, the better the model will be trained, right? And the better clustering is what we'll be seeing. So when we compute these three pluses denotes that these are the centroid of these three clusters, right? So this is what is the outcome you can see in the first iteration. But when we perform, when we repeat the same task, that is to make the partition, calculate the distance, and then assign that particular sample to the nearest cluster, right? So these three steps, when we repeat it continuously, we get better result. We get better clustering, right? So as you can see in the second iteration, the centroid of the clusters has been shifted, right? The centroid of the clusters, which were much more closer in the first iteration, are now little far from each other, thereby creating a different cluster, right? So we have this centroid, let's say this is the centroid of the green values, this is the centroid of the blue values, and this one is the centroid of the red values, right? So this is just the second iteration. Now more number of iterations that we see, the centroid are slightly more, getting far from the centers, right? Getting far from each other centroids, right? So the more number of iterations, again, let me take you directly to the sixth iteration. Let's say when we compute the sixth iteration, now you can clearly see that the samples has been clearly clustered, right? And we have three clusters wherein we have this particular cluster denoting the green values, right? This plus being the centroid of this particular cluster, and this is the cluster for the red values, and this plus symbol here is the centroid of this cluster, and similarly this is the blue cluster with this plus being the centroid of this, right? So this is now when we compare the iteration 1 with the iteration 6, right? When we compare the iteration 1 with the iteration 6, we can clearly say that iteration 6 is the better classification, better clustering than the iteration 1, right? So the other point to be noted here is the overfitting, right? We should also take care that the data shouldn't be overfitted, right? So we have already discussed this concept of underfitting and overfitting in the model 3, right? And in the introduction part of the model 4 as well. So the termination condition is what is very crucial here, very important, which will decide whether the model is overfitting or underfitting, right? So the termination condition will give you the better result, which will be perfect fit, right? Which one will be the perfect fit? So in this case, when we see that there is no change in the centroid values, we can say that it has been correctly clustered, and we don't have to further do iterations for further clustering, right? Okay, so this is about the k-means. Now let us have a look upon our source code, that how do we apply the EM algorithm as well as k-means algorithm to see the result, right? And when we apply both these two algorithms on the same data set, only then we can compare which algorithm is better. Right. What is the accuracy of each of these algorithms, and when to select which algorithm under what circumstances. Right. So here in this case, we are going to import the data set for the IRIS. Right. So IRIS, this is a popular data set which you must be already aware. So we are going to use this IRIS data set and apply both the EM algorithm as well as the k-means algorithm, and see that which one will be the better suitable algorithm for this particular data set. Right, so I've just commented a few of the lines here, which is basically you can remove these comments if you want to have a look upon the data. Right, so if you want to see what is the data and what are the different features and target values in this data set, right, so you can remove this comment and print and see the values, but as a part of the program it is not required, so I've just commented. So once we load this IRIS data, the next is to store the input, right? Whatever the input that we have as the pandas data frame file, right? So, and we are also going to give these some names, some column names for that particular data frame, right? So once we have that input, and then we can print those column, right? Those column names, let's say sepal length, then sepal width, petal length, and petal width. So these are the columns and column names that we have given, right? So we will have an example. We will see, have a look upon that as well, right? And then we are going to print the targets, set the size of the plot, and then ultimately plot the sepal as well as petal, right? Plot the sepal and plot the petal as well. So this plotting is basically done on the column names that we have given, that is the sepal length, sepal width, excuse me guys, sorry, sepal length, sepal width, petal length as well as petal width, right? So depending upon that, we have our, you know, the plot for the sepal as well as petal. So now, since we know about the input, we build the k-means model, right? Okay, so we build the k-means model. We perform the k-means clustering, which we just discussed using the algorithm. And then when we model the labels, right? And this is the array that you can see initially that we have initialized with all these zeros and ones and twos values, right? So this is the initial data, and using this we are going to visualize the classifier's result. Now this is very important because we are going to visualize the result here, and we are going to make some kind of classifications which will help us to identify which classification is better, right? So we are going to plot the original classification, then we are going to plot the model classification, right, which will be using the k-means classification, right? So just to give you an idea, this on the left is the real classification or the original classification, and on the right is the k-means classification. So as you can see, there is very slight difference. Mostly it is the same, but if you carefully observe, there is very slight difference from the real classification and the k-means classification. So we can say that our classification is fairly accurate, right? Not 100% accurate, but we can say it is fairly accurate, pretty much same, right? So once we have the original classification, the real classification, the k-means classification, we go ahead to replot the classification, right? The original and the predicted. Right now, this predicted will be with the corrected values, right? Whatever the values that we have changed, with modification of those values, we are going to again replot it. Right? So when we see now the real classification as well as the k-means classification, this is again a little far more better than the previous one. Right. So this is about the classification that we see, and which will help us to determine the measurement or the performance measurement for the the complete algorithm, right? And how do we compute the performance measure? By comparing the accuracy, right? So let's say we have the accuracy that which is let's say around 0.89, which is roughly around, let's say, 89% accurate, right? So let's say it is 89.3% accurate. Our model is 89.3% accurate, and once we have the accuracy, we are going to construct the confusion matrix, right? Confusion matrix using the arrays, right? So next step, which is again very important step, that is to compute the GMM, right? GMM is the Gaussian matrix, right? The Gaussian mixture model. For that, we need to import the scikit-learn right from the preprocessing. We put the scalar fit, we see the values for the sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and the petal width, and then we import the Gaussian mixture. Right? The Gaussian mixture will help us to fit these values, and then we compute the other parameters, that is the covariance, other iterations, maximum iterations, and those things, right? Mean value, component values, precision, and those other value. So this Gaussian mixture will give us some output which is, you know, mostly the same that we have initially seen. Right? So that shows that it is accurate. The data, the classification that we are getting here is fairly accurate. Right? So this GMM classification, which is nothing but it is using the EM algorithm, right? Expectation maximization algorithm. Now this is the classification that what we got from the GMM classification. Right. So when I have to compare this GMM classification with the K-means classification, let me show you the diagram. Yeah. So this on the left, on the right side is what we have, K-means classification. Right. And here in this diagram, what we have is the GMM classification, which is using the EM algorithm, expectation maximization algorithm. So you can see it is again, mostly it is the same. Both the classifications are somewhat successful to some extent, but as you can see, the accuracy here in the GMM, that is the Gaussian matrix, Gaussian matrix model, we have the accuracy around 96.6, right? So when we classify using the confusion matrix, we get we can see that it is fairly accurate, right? Fairly accurate to the real values. So 96.6 is a pretty much a good score, you can say, right? So we can say that the GMM clustering matched the true labels more closely than the K-means clustering, right? So in this case, we can say that the EM algorithm that what we have applied using the GMM, right, the Gaussian mixture model, right? So EM algorithm, expectation maximization algorithm, has performed better, or you can say it is more accurate, or you can say it is more close to the true values than what we have seen in the K-means algorithm. Right? So that clearly says that the, in comparison, when we try to do for the clustering, we can say that the EM algorithm is a better clustering algorithm than the K-means algorithm. Right? So with this, we can make a conclusion that the EM algorithm is a better classifier, a better clustering algorithm than the K-means algorithm. Right? So that is the ultimate comparison that comes up. Right. So I hope the session was interesting and you have gained insights as to which algorithm is better when we talk about clustering. Right. So if you have any doubt, we still have 4 minutes time. Can ask any doubts if you have. Yeah, anybody with any doubt? Yeah, guys, please sit there. Yeah, anybody having any doubt, please sit there. Okay, then so if there are no doubts, then we shall conclude the lecture.